Thank you very much. We have a two and a half year old daughter. She could really use that app of the carousel. Be very happy about that. We're going to do it a little bit differently. I'm going to talk about some of the research, and then Sarah's going to come up and talk about the build projects. We thought that that might make some more sense. So we thought we'd start by just showing this diagram of what we do. You guys are tall. All right. All right, I'm just getting myself situated here. All right, so here we are, UrbanLab there on the left. It's our firm. I teach at IIT, Sarah at UIC, and then we co-direct Archeworks. Archeworks is a nonprofit. Its mission, roughly speaking, is to address some of the social and environmental justice issues that are out there in the world, all related to design and how architects and designers can really work on that. That's our publication on the right, first one. We just started about a year ago, so we're getting there. If anybody wants that publication, email me, send it right to you. So I thought we'd start with four principles that or precepts that really frame our work, especially at the large scale. To think holistically about what we do, I would say one of our missions that we've given to ourselves is to try to see what giant scale architects can participate in these days. You know, what is the largest thing that we could actually get our hands on? And so these are some principles about infrastructure. And the first is just this idea of leveraging infrastructure to create public architecture, how one might do that. This is just a slide showing a project we did for the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago that really tries to rethink the pedestal of this museum, which was one of the more unfortunate buildings in Chicago over the last 25 years, where the before shot there on the left, you can see this kind of leftover non-public space that our idea was to kind of take that building off of its pedestal, look at the left behind and flood it with public program, basically taking the museum and bringing it out into the public space as itself a form of infrastructure. The second principle is this idea of rethinking infrastructure as new assemblages of the same stuff, but organized in totally different ways, in multifunctional ways. And also to connect the let's say, social and political agendas that are out there these days, kind of federal agendas and local agendas, and merge them with design agendas that we in this room all have, and some of our clients even have. This is a project in Cleveland. Cleveland is starting to see itself as a center for local, off-grid local. And all of the let's say, social and political agendas like urban agriculture, energy, local energy, recycling, micro-parks, all of these things can really be reconfigured tightly in a lot of different ways, and that's what a lot of the projects we'll show are about. Most cities, the average, most dense cities, let's say, are composed of about all of land, all the land taken together has about 40% of it as infrastructure. The streets, sidewalks, alleys, the void spaces in this image of Chicago are parks. So the idea is how can those sites be leveraged to become architectural at this scale? And you know, this is the terrain that I think architects these days really need to attend to somehow thinking this big. So here we are, Chicago and New York. Roughly speaking, we can say that New York was organized where it is, kind of part of its economic history, to take advantage of all the stuff here, sell it to Europe. This was hundreds of years ago, and that's New York became the center of where commodity trade happened. Chicago was set up only 150 years ago to do the same thing, but further west. So Chicago was set up, all of this area, Chicago consolidated all of the natural resources, adjusted them a little bit, sent them to New York, onto Europe. So, but it's through this water infrastructure that made Chicago what it was, and why people chose Chicago literally as this place to invest in and make it happen. So a lot of the projects that we'll show now are about this water infrastructure and really thinking about how water infrastructure can be a precursor to the design of architecture and new type of urban design. But it's not just about the environment, let's say, or ecology. If we were to take the Great Lakes Basin, which New York is part of, and take it out of its context of the United States, it would have the third largest economy in the world, this little island world. Japan is still second. China, of course, is predicted in the next 10 years to overcome all of this. But, you know, it's this real, $4 trillion a year juggernaut of economy at work. And then there's some other facts, like the United Nations basically telling us that 2 out of 3 people in the world will be facing water shortages in 2025, and that's really going to lead to a lot of conflict around the world. Water availability, kind of probably have a sense of this. The important part is that as we urbanize, we use multiple times the amount of resources that we otherwise use. So it's not just that we gain population all over the world, but the amount of, let's say, Americans that are evolving is really taxing resources, especially water. And in the United States, this is a map generated by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, who know that because for the first time in history we're building these huge cities, which are very popular in the United States, without any kind of clear idea of where water is going to come from, there's going to be all sorts of issues. But I wanted to frame some projects that we're doing in Chicago with what's happening in New York. We just took a quick look before we got here. You guys know all about this. This is one of the most successful systems in the world. It's the biggest untreated, unfiltered water system in the world. But it's got a couple of problems, of course. First of all, any development that happens around those preserved landscapes causes issues like this, and I just pulled a couple of these off the web. Bathing but not alone, essentially, where a shower in New York City carries tens of millions of microbes and bacteria that you breathe in, that you suck in, you know, that all of these things. And the more kind of sprawl exurban development that happens around your watershed, of course, the less sure you can be about the water supply. And then there's, of course, this constant friction with the energy economy, the idea that people are fighting right now to develop untapped gas sources underneath the aquifers that we're all drinking out of here is going to lead to very, very serious problems in the near future, potentially. So again, it's just this kind of political reality of and pressure, economic pressure. You probably know that you have a combined sewer system. So that was water coming in, water coming out, or going out. New York combines the black and gray water with stormwater. What happens though when it fills up? Those tunnels fill up, and they fill up every week, at least once a week, more than once a week. Is this enormous, 27 billions of gallons of water that essentially go untreated into the harbors. And that's a 4% of all of the water that gets flushed down the toilet goes there. So we just figured out real quick, that means that one out of every 25 flushes goes right into the New York Harbor. And so, that could be an issue also. So it goes down to this idea of decoupling, and this is what our project is about in Chicago. It's to think of ways of coming to grips with some of the kind of maintenance realities behind these big infrastructures and using them to try to leverage a new type of public architecture, basically separating the stormwater from the black and gray water. So this is the start of one of these projects. This one's called Growing Water. We're basically trying to create this very holistic system throughout Chicago to deal with stormwater. This is here a scale, just in case you guys don't know. of New York City and Chicago. They're the same scale. So Chicago is roughly 10 miles across, but it's close to the size of all of New York. So some facts, 20% of the Earth's fresh water, surface fresh water, is on deposit in the Great Lakes. 95% of the water in the United States somehow emanates from the Great Lakes. Chicagoans take out more than 1 billion gallons of water a day, and we put back less than 1% of that. And that less than 1% renewal rate is about the rate of a desert. Even the sub-Saharan desert somehow captures a little bit more than less than 1%. And that's because we basically take it out of Lake Michigan, use it, let it get rained on, let it get kind of nice and dirty as it gets mixed together, and then it goes to the Gulf of Mexico, or we purposefully send it to the Gulf of Mexico. And down at the Gulf of Mexico, this red area indicates this dead zone that's down there. It's basically over-oxygenated, over tons of nutrients that really not much can live in. And that's the state of Louisiana there in Texas. One more digression before I actually get into the project here. But basically, this is about political decision-making. Number four, the Aral Sea, used in 1960, was the fourth largest inland body of water. You can see Lake Michigan right above that, just for scale. Between the 60s and 2006, this is what's kind of happening. And that's the New York City and Chicago now are in relationship to the Aral Sea. The reason is just political decision-making. The some politicians basically said that they were going to favor agricultural economies versus water economies. And we all know once kind of large resources go away, it's really impossible to get them back. It takes tens and hundreds of years and really and money that no one has. And of course, once something goes away, when it starts to go away and gets really bad, it just gets incredibly polluted and things just completely degrade. So it's just a cautionary tale, let's say, just in case you didn't know about this story. So back to the project. Real quick history of Chicago. Chicago sits on a subcontinental divide. Basically, this divide, everything by gravity either goes down this way or this way. So drop a glass of water on one side of it, goes into the Mississippi, drop a glass on the other side. If it doesn't evaporate, it goes into the Great Lakes. We ourselves have some experience with radical shifting of infrastructure. We reversed our own river about 100 years ago. And this was essentially the moment where we said, let's not return any water to the Great Lakes. Let's return it. Let's bring it over to the Mississippi. We did this for sanitation reasons, but there's really no reason for it to be still like this, let's say. And then we have our own deep tunnel, which some people think is the biggest infrastructural project in the world. 109 miles of this thermos that essentially takes all of the water when it rains, when you flush, on this side of the subcontinental divide, and brings it all to this point on the other side of the subcontinental divide in order to get rid of it. So this brings us all to this project, Growing Clean Water. We moved it out 100 years because we didn't think it would take a shorter time than that. 2106 is a play on 2016, which is the potential Olympic year. I'll get more to that in a second. But so the idea is to create a system that is very democratically spread or evenly spread through the city using the public way, using infrastructure that we all own, that we all could theoretically have some say in. These are the streets and the sidewalks and the public parks. To create this system that really intensifies all of those existing kind of green infrastructures and essentially tries to catch all of the rainwater and deal with a lot of the gray water in the city, consolidate it, sequester it, and then after capturing it, recycle it back into the Great Lakes through these kind of green fingers almost from the subcontinental divide to the lake as what we call eco-boulevards. Here's just a kind of catalog of all of the kind of wish list that we hope that could be in these. And it's very hybrid in the sense that there's still, of course, cars. I mean, no one, I think, in the right mind would suggest getting rid of cars at this point. But it also has lots of different social spaces. All of this under the kind of rubric of trying to deal with water in the smartest way possible, but transforming these roads, basically putting these roads on a diet to take back a lot of the what could be very public in a very dense situation, and creating spaces that people can really use. So I'll go through a little bit on how that might work. So these eco boulevards essentially use very natural systems that have proven to work perfectly forever. And just the water basically can be cleaned with nature itself as it moves down the system. And it's essentially about closing this loop. Today sort of sends everything away, tomorrow bring it all back and capture it and hold on to this resource that in the future, the not so distant future, really will be an incredibly important resource. Chicago gets sued every day by some other city or country that says, look at you guys, you're not using your water in a way that should allow you to be stewards of that resource. We should be able to come in there and take it because you don't use it properly. And these the lawsuits are from places like Las Vegas, China. Everybody just wants to come in and grab it. There's one Supreme Court law that says nobody can. But, you know, that could be argued away. There's beyond the kind of ecological function is the social function. This is a street called 31st Street in Chicago. And the idea is to look at all of the parks along a very typical urban dense street, be it a school park, be it a park attached to a kind of large condo project or something, and really get these all of these green pieces in the city working together for some broader good. And of course, the idea that one could walk this system or bike it is very important. And this is a highly idealized version of what it could look like one day. So here's where the project is today. That project was started for the History Channel, but then it kind of evolved into a couple of different ways that were so that it's still alive. One way is not still alive, and this is the Olympic plan of Chicago. These green lines running east-west represent the Eco Boulevard idea. All of the venues for the entire Olympics are little circles there. The idea was to the International Olympic Committee doesn't allow any venues to have parking. It's not legal, or at least you can't do it. So the idea was to connect all the venues with all the main public parks along the edge of the water, which there are a lot of, with all the public transportation, and essentially to try to stimulate the Eco Boulevard project through the Olympics. And this would be a kind of landmark of on the lakefront, people walking to the different venues to say, okay, there's a venue back there. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. What that picture is a living machine. Living machines exist today. That's us standing in one on the upper right there, but they haven't been designed yet. No architect has really gone in and said, you know, we need to do it this way so that it can function in a city in a dense situation. And of course, it could be multi-programmed. And the other way that the project is still alive is through the City of Chicago Department of Transportation. Through the DOT, the CDOT in this case, we're working on essentially a toolbox of kind of best practices on how we can slowly but surely integrate Eco Boulevard concepts, basically water infiltration concepts and micro park concepts, into the everyday work of the city upgrading, renovating, creating new streets, you know, which has $1 billion budget every year, essentially. So it's basically to institutionalize some of these ideas so that they become standard, using the same money that's already being used, essentially. And here are some of the toolbox, kind of a very one image of what that kind of looks like, basically looking at the road profiles and thinking about the different program, both the ecological program and the social program that could be identified with each. Real quick, had to break this one out. You know, this is kind of the opposite of what one would think to do these days, but this was done in Buckminster Fuller did this in relationship to energy, but really this shield, you know, prevents water to come from entering the city. You know, the city can be a sponge. It wants to be a sponge. It also, by the way, prevents UV rays from killing bacteria and things, but it's okay. But I wanted to introduce that idea because we're now working on this project. This also started as a competition very recently for just a very speculative idea called WPA 2.0, started by CityLab. But our idea was to see, to take this idea of infrastructure a little further, combine it with some of the stimulus, infrastructural stimulus ideas that Obama has, these federal ideas of reinvesting in cities, and try to bring them together to basically come up with the answer for a question that could be, what catalyst is necessary in terms of investing in infrastructure to really help cities? You know, not just reinvesting in some street that's gonna go from nowhere to nowhere, essentially. So we all know the biggest catalyst in our recent history, cheap oil, or cheap energy anyway, has kind of gone on to do all sorts of great things and not so great things. It's itself a kind of economy. Again, this idea that when water is so valuable in the future, it will be the new oil. And Chicago, or I should say the Great Lakes, are really the Saudi Arabia of this particular resource. But what the Great Lakes are not, what they don't have is jobs. And the Great Lakes, for instance, have lost 2 million industrial jobs over the last decade. The infrastructure is not set up to create a healthy environment at all. So the proposal is to design this water-based infrastructure to attract water-intensive industries, jobs, and dollars. The type of industries that could be attracted are the ones that use so much water. This is a kind of virtual water map of industries. And so the idea is simply free water. And that could that attract industries from, for instance, the Sun Belt, which is really kind of running out of water, to the Rust Belt, which is running out of jobs. If we look at some quick case studies, we see that a place like Iceland is leveraging free energy to attract businesses like the aluminum industry, which uses 2% of all electrical energy in the world. Free labor in Vancouver, the Hollywood of the North. Free labor is basically tax credits. So the idea is to create these free water districts. Each city, like Chicago, could potentially get one. Free water is not necessarily free, but the idea is to use it and to recapture it and send it back. In the meantime, to really cleanse a lot of the post-industrial sites, which are all over the Great Lakes. There's enormous amount of brownfields that are really polluted, that need to be cleaned up, but they are very infrastructure rich. They really have a lot of infrastructure ready to go. And then to use some of the resources that are a little bit inland to really make some of this happen in a more synergistic way. So step one is basically to create this public investment, which is essentially a stormwater sewer. It could be multifunctional, for instance, lift up to create a kind of recycling center, which essentially moves resources around in a kind of industrial ecology through the system. And then our basic idea is to try to create some kind of, we're developing this right now, we just kind of pulled these off the computer, but develop an idea of a research university being involved. And then essentially this is how the system would operate when it rains in Chicago, or I should say wherever this would be, because it's not really cited right now. And this would, to get the combined sewer system offline, one has to have place for the water to go. This kind of mat here essentially looks at what some of the industries might, how they might come together. All right, and this section shows the relationship between the landscape, some of those underground things, which are things like parking and very necessary program, and the buildings themselves. All right, I'm gonna try to get Sarah up here immediately, so I'm gonna go through this one really fast. This project spawned a built project, so I'm just gonna show it real quick. This is a competition that we did in South Korea. It's for a central open space, which is basically this green heart of a new city. That new city would be in the north here. 500,000 people would just move there practically overnight. And this would be one of the new administrative areas in the city. The competition is for the kind of central park of it. And you can see the scale relationship there. The brief called for process-oriented, non-hierarchical, open-ended, sustainable project. So what we did, what we tried to do is look at some software that we had been literally playing with. This software is made called NetLogo. It's free off the web. It's made for elementary school kids to learn about complexity theory. It's very easy to use. So we thought we'd make a game, essentially, using slime mold. And it's essentially looking at aggregation behavior of slime mold. Basically, how slime mold aggregates into clusters when under stress. It just operates under three rules. They are drop, sniff, and follow. Essentially, if there's stress in the environment, slime mold drops a little pheromone in the landscape. They sniff ahead to see if there's other slime dropping pheromones. And then they follow and then congregate. The idea is that they're stronger together, but they do this without a leader. It's like flocking, birds flocking, fish flocking. It's this idea that you get this incredibly coherent pattern without somebody just saying, let's do this as a kind of leader or even master planner, as kind of bring it back into architecture. So our rules basically got split into program, both social program and ecological program. The social program essentially has things like activities, events, facilities, that sort of thing, and gets arrayed through this program, based upon adjacencies of what goes best together across the site in these social patches. The idea with the patches making them circle is that a circle has the least area of permeability. It only touches its neighbor in four spots, technically. So it's trying to get at least the initial state being stable, even though it is open to change over time. Ecological program, wetlands, marsh, even things like swimming, then is in these ecological patches. They are in relationship to the social patches, and they're set up to allow the site to operate as a holistic landscape. Ecological fingers are created to make sure that the two water pieces on the site can flow throughout. And then there are these strands, these corridors. These corridors are circulation. They're for things to move in and out, nature and wildlife to cohere or to separate. And it really just creates a system of organizing between the patches. And the corridors essentially created to just have kind of intimacy and privacy versus a kind of opacity in the landscape. And here's the kind of final open work. I'm just going to go through this quickly. And here's just a final rendering of what that might have looked like. But I'm trying to get to Sarah here because she's going to talk about how we use this in a build project and talk about some other build projects.
So we actually have built a few things, surprisingly. This next project is the courtyard renovation for the Smart Museum at the University of Chicago. Well, since we didn't win the costs competition, we thought we would try to actually, on a very small scale with very low tech, try to actually test the ideas from costs at the University of Chicago. So the site is an existing courtyard at the university in between two buildings, the art history building and a museum of art. Every day, students from both buildings circulate out onto the courtyard, and also students pass through. So we thought this would be an interesting sort of group of people to experiment on. What we did was we took a couple of rules from COS and sort of played this little mini game at a very small scale to see what would happen. Actually, going back really quickly, here we have cultural patches and ecological patches. The cultural patches, a hill patch, a lawn patch where art projects might happen, the hill patch where a classroom might happen. The two buildings by SOM were originally sort of spread out between a very flat landscape, and so we actually introduced sort of undulating landscape that may kind of actually spark some new cultural interaction between these two groups of art historians and artists. The mound here is, as I mentioned, a classroom, and over here is a cafe patch, and beyond here is an art, sort of multi-purpose art patch where art might be made at these kind of moments of the public coming into the art courtyard and doing stuff. There's also sculpture patches and planting patches, and these planting patches serve to somehow add a little bit of water remediation into the landscape. The mound, and unfortunately taking the picture on a day when no classes were in session, but usually this is overtaken by sophomores who are getting some sun. The landscape is still growing in. And there's another view of the cafe patch and the classroom patch. So we're pretty interested in this kind of leveraging also of problems and taking problems and thinking about them as actual potential amenities. This is a project that we were going to claim not necessarily as our own house and office, but Amal busted us. So this is, while we were waiting for the phone to ring in Chicago, we're not either one of us from Chicago, and spent many years kind of waiting by the phone. We decided we would actually build our own live and work space. The site actually had two kind of pretty dramatic constraints. The first was that the zoning was such that you could only live on the second floor or higher, zoned commercial. And the second was that on the site there was this building that had already been condemned by the city when we bought the land. The city, we looked at kind of salvaging the building and renovating it, but it was literally falling into the basement. It had to go. So we demolished the building, and instead of taking the demo to a landfill, we demolished it and formed the demo into a mound. And this actually had the consequence of solving both problems. We could kind of be more sustainable, for lack of a better word, but at the same time, we could actually produce this amenity and sort of do a Muhammad in the mountain sort of moment and bring the landscape up to the second floor, because in Chicago, it's so flat, they don't have any rules about landscape. They don't understand landscape at all. So all of a sudden, we have this hill. There are no rules for hills. So we like to play with the rules and kind of break the rules every once in a while, but not really. So we rearranged the FAR, lifted the living zone out off the ground, twisted it, and bridged it between this new mound of demo and then prairie grass and our office. And so what you get is this kind of new outside room here, and you get this potential for the living space to open literally out onto this kind of stripy recycled mound. This necessitated us kind of making some landscape drawings as architects and realizing that we wanted this super graphic mound, but it's really hard in landscape to actually make things so precise, so we're learning the hard way. The additional benefit is that this mound creates this kind of outdoor space between the office and the mound, which becomes possibly a gallery. The second floor is literally a bridge from and structurally separate from the office below. So there's two columns pretty much right here and here on this side, and two on this side, one and another, and in between two trusses which span this space. And this is obviously a slight homage to the Farnsworth house, and not a good one, but anyway. So the mound actually serves as a sort of also ecological function in that it sequesters rainwater in a really interesting way. The prairie grasses absorb and hold on the site water for a much longer period of time than, for example, grass. We are effectively, in terms of rainwater, off the sewer grid. And we get this kind of interesting landscape to boot. And on nice days, on the few nice days there are in Chicago, we can pretend that we live in LA when we open up our garage door and kind of, well, see this kind of weird urban, stripy prairie landscape outside. This is actually a model photo, and this is a photo of the building sort of in construction. It's still in construction. It doesn't look this unconstructed, but this is kind of the moment when we're forming the mound. Actually, what we realized was the city was going to get really nervous about this mound. We didn't draw it in our drawings. So we had the mound spread out all over, the demo was sort of spread all over the site, and so it made the site about 2 feet taller. They didn't realize that the site was 2 feet taller, and then at the end we formed it back up into a hill. This is the two trusses getting installed, and they're actually different from each other. We were playing with this kind of served service space in between this truss and the exterior facade, and thinking about how we could also program that. Where we programmed and needed some sort of easy access, like a bookshelf or a kitchen, we made the truss members straight. And where we didn't really mind, for example, in front of a window, like here, we let them be diagonal. And so they're two different, and they're both programmed differently. And so here we are with the stripy mound here. That's the cap for scale. Our office and our apartment. And this is where we kind of can sort of see our landscape really directly. The neighborhood is a little bit gritty. And so we, south side, super south side, we proposed this skin of Corten at the base and the office. We have, obviously, like everybody, a lot of computers, even though once you buy a computer, it's effectively worthless. The neighbors don't necessarily think that. And so it's Corten, and it's perfect for getting tagged. It gets tagged all the time. And what we do is we sandblast, the city blasts it off for free, and then we add a little bit of lemon juice, and it goes back eventually to the Corten. And we have this kind of running obsession with this low-tech metal skin that's perforated in some way in order to kind of achieve certain types of effects, which we really like here at the front gate where the light comes through. And then upstairs, this is our living area, really clean, our bookshelf. So there's this zone, our bookshelf actually ended up going in the wrong spot, but still works. And this is the living space. And that's what it's like to live in Chicago. This next project is a house. We continued with this kind of idea. This time we were actually really interested in a figure. The site is at the border between a prairie landscape and a forest landscape. And we sort of really wanted to, in a similar way to Slade Architects, sort of take advantage of both landscapes at the same time. The prairie landscape was a kind of ongoing remediation project by the clients, and the forest landscape is sort of interesting in that it ran down to a creek down in the middle of the site. So it's 14 acres, 2.5 hours away from Chicago. So we're thinking about how can we sort of make this work, and then we realized that if we read the figure of the X as a kind of a void, we would achieve this kind of instantly. So what we did was we did read this as a void, and we organized a very simple volume around it. So we effectively carved the X out of a rectangular sort of shoebox shape. And this gave us this sort of communal space in the middle, which we were always sort of interested in, and on either side, these private spaces. The private spaces house the bedrooms and the bathrooms and the mudroom and the electrical room and the kitchen. And then the public space is kind of dining and living and kind of being. And the idea was to sort of make that space feel like it's part of the landscape. Are you in the landscape or are you seeing the landscape? Could we open it up enough to blur the boundaries? We also sculpted sort of in 3D and allowed the living and the dining spaces sort of open out onto their respective landscapes. In sort of deference to the topography, we used the topo lines to sort of literally enclose this volume and chose a really inexpensive knotty pine, which is also super graphic, which we really liked, to kind of wrap that zone with. And so here is the little house on the prairie. And the kind of figure extends out into the landscape. The side private zones are, we're interested to kind of make them as camouflaged as possible. Here we're using aluminum that we actually had perforated and then corrugated instead of galvalum so that we could perforate it. And keeping these, but allowing this kind of, these private zones to have operable screens so that the people who live here can actually have different experiences of the nature that they live in. At the same time, the middle space, the knotty pine kind of X space, really is in sort of in contrast to those side spaces and how we treat the just everything about this space versus this space. We spent all of our money on this, obviously. And some photos of how it sits in the landscape, and here we are at the kind of entry coming into the living space, and we have another Doug Garofalo fire orb because they're awesome. And he's a friend of ours. And we worked also on the interiors to sort of camouflage the secret sort of private bedrooms. And so here's the door to the master bedroom, and the door to the other bedroom suite on the other side is the same, but to try to make it as kind of camo as possible. And the kitchen is the moment where the rule is broken. It's both kind of part of the private and part of the communal. And then here's the kind of view of the outside and the difference between the private and the communal. And then the private zones can be, the doors can be opened by the inhabitants and very easily operated, sort of super low tech. And this is the master bedroom, looking again at the effects of that perforation and the light and how the light comes through the leaves and through the perforation over the course of the day. It's really kind of interesting, looking from outside in and inside out. And then this kind of perforated, very leafy kind of thing that moves through the house throughout the day. And the last project we'll show is a project we're working on right now. Again, a pretty simple diagram. Leveraging the site in some way. The house is in Los Angeles in a neighborhood called Echo Park. And two interesting things about the site, besides the fact that it's insanely steep, is that if you get high enough on the hill, you can see the Hollywood sign. But from anywhere on the hill, you can actually see this really beautiful view of a national forest. And so what we did was stealing a little bit of a concept from a project that we didn't show competition in Korea for a museum. We thought we would actually kind of peel the landscape up, and under that would be the kind of private zone of the living of the sleeping spaces, and then excavate the ground in order to make this kind of more expansive space. So the upper level would be oriented towards the Hollywood sign. The lower level would be oriented towards the kind of expansive view of the mountains. And this is a very simple diagram model of it. And working really hard not to lose this. Some early plans and some more recent plans. We're actually in permit review and arguing about retaining walls with the city. The upstairs view plan of bedrooms and studio. It's kind of burned out on that. And anyway, this section of the kind of closed upper level and open lower level. Now we're kind of experimenting again with the skin. Again, kind of boring at this point, probably. This is sort of an understanding of this really dialectic nature of the private versus the more public and communal, and experimenting again with perforation and corrugation, this time in Corten, in order to sort of fit with the landscape. This is from the bedroom, looking at the Hollywood sign. You can just see it here. Can you? Yeah, that's the Hollywood sign. And this is the lower level, the living level, which has the kind of more horizontal LA sort of feel. And this is what it is to live in LA for us. Thank you.